Hi, Martin. How is it?
Yeah, I'm really good, Nana. It's really good to be here speaking to you today.
Likewise. Welcome, welcome. This episode, I think it's going to be very, very useful for people that are like myself, investing abroad or remotely, how they can think and ask questions. Because we have heard very many horror stories when using builders overseas. So I hope you can help. So could you
Yeah, I'm
tell who
sure I
you
will.
are?
Yeah,
Who are
yeah.
you? Who
So,
is Martin?
I am, one of those guys that came to property with a lot of skills, which I didn't realize I had in the first place. I left school in the 1980s. I went and worked for a building contractor. I was a quantity surveyor. That's the person who looks after the finances for the contractor. And I managed projects primarily around London. What I started to find was actually I got excited about the complicated projects rather than the easy projects, and rather than some of the run-of-the-mill projects. And I ended up working in places like museums and banks, and I was in the Bank of England, the Stock Exchange, where
Oh,
it wasn't
wow.
just the managing of the project that was complex. We had to manage the security, the access, delivery times to avoid the public. We couldn't have noise. We had noise restrictions. And I got really into the logistical side of things. And so I got to a point where I was kind of managing these whole projects. I was a project manager for building contractors, and I was loving it. And then kind of the last recession, 2007, 2008, 2009, things got really hard. The company I worked for wasn't really going anywhere. I was getting fed up and I thought, well, I'm gonna have to go elsewhere. Difficult, obviously, to get another job. Didn't want to be the last one in, first one out. So I said, I'm gonna set up my own business. And I set up a business that was a complete clone of the company I'd walked out of. I'd gone from number two in that company to one in my company. But what I hadn't realized was that I couldn't easily get all of these prestigious projects because my company hadn't got years and years of trading experience, even though I had, and even though I knew the clients, I couldn't get it worked. So, which was a bit frustrating because I hadn't really thought about that before I set up my own business. And someone said to me, you should go along to some property investing meetings, Martin, because they all want building contractors. You'll find clients there. And I said, well, that's a good idea. Not really thought about that. Went along, sure enough, got me a little opportunity to stand up and introduce myself. And within no time, I'm meeting property investors who needed building contractors. And I started going out and looking at these projects with these investors. And it was like a real eye-opener for me that a lot of them in those days, and this is now back in 2012, a lot of them didn't really know what they were doing. And they would say things to me like, Martin, so we want to build this extension on the back of the house. And I'll say, well, have you got planning permission? They say, no, we don't need planning permission. It's permitted development. And I'll say, no, that extension that's already on the back of the house, that's the permitted development. You can't have another go. And they would show me planning drawings. They say, so when can you start? And I'd say, well, you need building regulation drawings. And they say, what are building regulation drawings? And I've got these drawings. And I say, well, that you need something that tells you how to build it. And I'm starting to think there's a whole world of people here that seriously just need someone to guide them. The final straw was a guy. I priced a project for a job. A guy who wanted to convert his house into an HMO. Now, I didn't know what an HMO was back in those days, but I didn't let on. I just kept asking questions until I worked it all out. But I gave him a quote for doing this work. It was about £60,000. And I rang him up a week later and said, what did you think of the price? He said, oh, it's too expensive, Martin. I can't afford it. I said, well, you needed a lot. It had a roof, it had a problem with the roof. It needed new central heating, new electrics. It needed everything. And I said, how much were you expecting? He said, £30,000. And I said, where did £30,000 come from? And he said, it's the difference between what I bought it for and what it's going to be worth after we've finished all the work. And my brain said, well, then you've bought it for too much money, haven't you? You've paid the wrong price for it. And all at the same time, I'm thinking, do you know, I'm getting a bit fed up running a building business. Do you know, what I really want to do is become a consultant. And why don't I become a consultant for all of these property investors that really just had what were small gaps in their knowledge. And if I thought, if I could just plug up this gap, if I can help someone understand how planning works, then they haven't got that problem anymore. They can just move forwards and they can grow their business. And that's what I've been doing since 2013.
Wow.
Working with property investors and being a property investor as well now.
Yeah. So do you said back then there wasn't so good. Do you think that it has changed now then? Or property investors better now?
I think the thing now is there's a lot more training opportunities. There's also a lot more online social media discussion going on. Now, that's not to say it's covering all bases, because it definitely isn't. And the average training course in property investing circles doesn't really spend any time talking about the refurbishment side of things. It might come up in one little module. And the usual thing with social media is the questions. You have to know you've got a gap in your knowledge to ask the question. If you don't know you've got a gap, you don't know it, you don't ask questions. Yeah. So I think, yes, it's better now than it was. There's a lot more awareness of it than it was. It's a lot easier to do research. You know, if you go back, what was now 9 years ago, there was discussion on the internet, but nowhere near what there is now. So you can find it. And I think there's a lot more people doing it now. I mean, it's hard to say because I'm now immersed in property investing circles, so it feels like that everyone's doing property investing. But I think the knowledge of property investing is out in the media and is out in the public domain better than it was 9 years ago.
Okay. So let's jump right into it. So I have some questions here.
Okay.
So what are the common mistakes property investors make doing refurbishment?
I think there's a couple of common mistakes. The first one is a lot of them don't do a proper appraisal in the first place. They buy the wrong property, or they underestimate what it's going to cost, or the logistics of the conversion, or they get over ambitious about end valuations, which just squeezes everything. So that's the first big mistake I see them make. And the second mistake I see them make is not really having a clear schedule of works, not being totally clear what they want to do. And this fella that I spoke about years ago, he said to me, I want to convert this into an HMO. Well, we've all got, I could put 20 people in a room and we'd all have different ideas about an HMO. None of us are right. None of us are wrong. It's just what we want to do. And I would encourage every investor to be writing down what do they want to get from their HMO? Who is their target market? What do they demand? What is going to make their HMO stand out from the one further down the street? How are they going to maximize their value and things like that? So I think, they're the two things that I see property investors overlooking.
Okay. So where do you see where you can add value most in property? Like in this hot market, it's really hard to find, like you mentioned, below market value and do the normal BRR. Where should you, as an investor doing these times?
I think you've got to look creatively. You've got to look beyond the really obvious solution. So if the estate agent's telling you there's scope for a rear extension, that's obvious. You've got to look at how can I get more rear extension? Is it a two-story? Is there scope to go to the side? Ultimately, in this country, we add value to properties, or property values goes up on bedrooms. If we can add an additional bedroom, a four-bedroom house is always worth more than a three-bedroom. And so we need to be looking at ways of adding bedrooms, or on bigger schemes, adding another flat. Yeah, so if it's got planning to convert a property into three flats, you should be saying, how can I get four flats from this? Because that's where the real value is.
Yeah, because that's very interesting, because in Sweden, it's mostly they just focus on like the kitchen and the bathroom. Mm. But like you mentioned, I have thought about that. It's about the bedrooms. But now when you're confirming it even more, it's like you're saying. you can see on the price.
Yeah, and okay. I mean, you just look on Rightmove any day. Rightmove, the first thing they say is 3-bedroom house. You know, that's how we market everything. So if that's suddenly a 4-bedroom house, it's in the next price bracket up. It's in the next value up.
So that's where you see people most forget to add value, the bedrooms.
Yeah, that's right. And 2 smaller bedrooms is worth more than 1 big bedroom, even though it's exactly the same square footage. Yeah, maybe a little less so in the centre of cities, but out in suburbia, that extra bedroom is worth more.
Because sometimes, because that's a really good answer you gave there, but I have a follow-up question to that. Because sometimes you see on Rightmove, there's 2 small bedrooms. Let's say it's a 3-bed, so they've done it to it was from originally a 2-beds, but they've done 2 small bedrooms and 1 big bedroom. And from here, like from Sweden, we're not used to live with very, very small rooms. And we're like, you cannot even fit a bed in that, or even you can just fit a bed and then you don't have any more room, Does properties like that let out? Do they get let out?
I think in reality, anything will get let out at the right price point. And clearly, a 3-bedroom house with 2 very small bedrooms is not worth as much as a 3-bedroom house with 3 nice big bedrooms. But at the right price point, yes, it will rent. The risk is, I think, you're going to get more churn. If you might rent that to a family and it absolutely ticks all their boxes and that's all they can afford. And it's because it's pitched at a lower price, they can afford a 3-bedroom house rather than a 2-bedroom house. So they're going to take it and they're going to stay there for years. But I think you could find a growing family, say, actually, now the kids are teenagers, these 2 bedrooms are too small, we've got to move on. So you do get that kind of churn. So when I say, adding value, bedrooms will add value. But of course, if they're too compromised, you've got other challenges. But per se, if that was a 2-bedroom house, it might be worth 200 grand. As a 3-bedroom house, just by cutting the big bedroom in half, it might be worth £220,000. Well, for the cost of 1 wall, you've added on £20,000 of value. Yeah, these are generic figures, but it's that kind of thing, really.
Yeah.
But you're not going to rent it at as much as you would do a nice big family 3-bedroom house, of course.
So maybe it's best to do it when you, like, if you like these people that I've seen on Rightmove, maybe it's best to do it when you're doing a flip than to selling on.
That's it. I think you've got to, that's another thing, really, is you start with the end in mind. Are you flipping this or are you renting it? And are you therefore doing the right thing? And actually, many would say 2 small bedrooms isn't so good. You do better having 1 very small bedroom and 1 a bit bigger. And sometimes that doesn't work. And I talk to property investors now. They come to me with projects that they want to do, and you talk it through with them. And it's like, well, hold on. Are you really sure this is going to work? As you say, I don't think by the time you've got the bed in, you can barely open the door. Is this, is your scheme actually viable? And some property investors almost just need someone to help them understand the logistics. They show me drawings and I say, why don't you get the architect to draw the bed in? And they come back with a bed and it's like, it doesn't fit. It's like, I could see that from your drawing, but now you've, you've realized that if you just ask the architect to draw the bed in, it proves it. You can do that on the next deal.
Yeah, definitely. So I know that you're aware of everything with this COVID and things going up everywhere. So building costs, has it increased in the UK as well?
Yeah, definitely it has. And it's not just COVID. I think there's a number of factors in here that have affected building costs in the UK. First of all, definitely COVID, because I think we've had a lot of tradesmen that got furloughed and have probably gone off and done, now got a different career, taxi driver, delivering for Uber or whatever, realise that that's probably an easier career than running a building business. So we've definitely lost resources from that. So that's supply and demand has pushed up prices. I think Brexit has also caused a fair amount of our foreign resources to go back home, some which probably weren't even allowed to be here in the first place. But, you know, that in itself has also affected. But I think the other thing that's, yeah, so that's kind of as far as shortage of supply of labour. But we've also got massively improved our building regulations. And that's causing the cost of materials and labour to increase. And particularly, you'd have heard about the Grenfell fire from which, what now was, I think, probably 3 years ago. But that's made a massive difference to the fire protection that we put in our buildings over here. And you know, even from basic fire alarm, leave alone means of escape. I've got an HMO I'm putting a misting system into at the moment. And so that is all cost, leave alone the fact that we now all want energy efficient houses. So that's better insulation. So again, more cost. So I think three factors are sending costs, spiraling upwards.
So just like be a little bit generic, how much percentage do you think it has risen compared to maybe 1-2 years ago?
I was going to say, if we go back 2 years, I would be surprised if it's not 10%.
Yeah, wow.
Would be surprised if it's not. I've not really done the comparison, but that's where I'd feel it probably is headed.
Yeah. So as you're aware, as I mentioned before, we're from Sweden. We do this remotely. So what should we ask our builders during projects or the project manager?
Let's just split the role of project manager first, because
yes,
if there are project managers that work for builders, and in fact that's what I did for a large part of my professional career, as it were. The second project manager is either you that are managing the whole project, buying the property and working out what you're going to do with it and renting it out, or you might outsource most, if not all, of that to a project manager. Now, if you're working remotely, you need someone on the ground that can manage those projects for you that you can trust. And whilst I wouldn't say you can't trust a builder, you've got to remember that a builder is looking after their own interests first. If you've employed them to refurbish a property, and I know this because I was managing the builder on the other side. If we messed up, I didn't tell my client we'd messed up. We'd sort out and we'd put it straight. Whereas now I'm working as an independent consultant, I'm sitting between clients that in some cases are remote or are running a business that precludes them from being too hands-on. And a builder, and I'm going back to my client saying, the builder's telling me he's on time, but I think he's talking a load of rubbish. I think he's a week behind at the moment, and he's got this challenge, and we've sorted this out. Yeah, so I'm reporting back the true information. So really, if you're working remotely, my typical advice would be have someone on the ground that you can trust, call them a project manager or another property investor, that is going to give you the true story, not what the builder wants you to hear. And what I do with all of my clients is I ensure that I go to, or me or one of my team goes to every project at least once a week. And every week we do a written report, we take photographs, and some of them will do, we'll do videos as well, on WhatsApp and things like that. So in many ways, you shouldn't have to ask any questions. If you've got the right person on the ground, you should get fed everything backwards. And really, your questions should be, are they on time? Are they on budget? Because both of them affect your next steps. Do I need to find more money, or do we need to rein in some spending? And when do I start talking to the letting agent about renting this property out? How does that fit into my timeline?
So what do you see that people miss when they like tell their project manager, or like you mentioned, a friend or someone looking after, checking up on them? What do they miss when they like maybe recording or asking? Is there any typical things you see?
I think the mistake that gets made is that answers from the builder are too often taken on face value. So a builder will say, we did this because it's how we always do it, rather than, well, what were the other, well, what are the other options? Because might one of those other options have been preferable in this situation? Yeah, whatever that solution might be. Yeah, builders will naturally think, we're property investors, we want everything done on the cheap. So you know, you had a problem, so I fixed it, it's really cheap. And actually, we don't, because if we're going to rent this property out for the next 10 years, we don't want it to break in 2 years' time when we've got tenants in it. We might have been prepared to pay for a better solution, and it will last 10 years. Or the builders say, I can solve this problem for you. It'll cost about £500. So do you want me to do it? And it's like, yeah, people say, yeah, get on with it. And then 3 weeks later, it's like, well, hold on, you haven't done anything yet. Oh, no, because the specialist bit of plant or the specialist material I needed is on a 6 weeks delivery. And it's like, well, hold on, if we'd have asked the question, is there another alternative? Had we asked what the time was, and they said 6 weeks, we said, well, what's, there is this alternative product, but it will cost you £1,000. But so we need to ask more questions. We need to delve deeper and understand better so that we can make the right decisions for us, which is not always cost. Sometimes it's time, sometimes it's quality. And I think for me, for any of my clients, anyone I'm working with, I want to give them all of the options. You know, this is the cheap fix, this is the quick fix, this is the belt and braces fix. Now you've got those decisions in front of you with a time implication and a cost implication. Now you can make the right decision for you. And obviously with my experience, I'll give my thoughts and the guidance, but you know, builders will only come up with one solution. We've got to really encourage them to come up with more than one for us.
Yeah. So that's always a really good answer. And I have a follow-up question that I maybe should have asked before this question is, people that doing this remotely, where should they find their builders? And what questions should they ask, like if they have insurance, et cetera? If you could maybe go through that step.
Yeah. So without any doubt, finding builders remotely is definitely tricky, because I think you need one-to-one interaction with your builders, and you need as much of that as you can before you finally press the button and say, yes, this is the builder I'm going to employ. Which, of course, if you're remote, you're not able to necessarily see them on other sites, which is why really, to some extent, if you are going to try and do it remotely, you need someone tried and trusted on the ground that can interface with builders. So, yeah, because any builder, you know, can give you a CV and show you how good they are. You know, here's a nice, pretty picture of something I built earlier this year. Even here's my insurances. Here's some testimonials. By the way, it was written by my mum. You know, that only when you meet them face to face, you see the whites of their eyes. They're showing you around a project they're doing at the moment. Do you get that real feeling that, yeah, actually, I'm walking around this project, it feels like it's well organized. It looks like it's good quality. The guys I'm meeting here are all friendly and courteous to me, rather than, does it feel like, you know, they haven't got a clue what they're doing? So yeah. When I'm looking for any builder, I'm not really looking for good builders. I'm almost turning on its head. I'm kind of saying, is this a builder that could be possible to work with? If the answer is no, it's like, well, let's not have any more conversations. You know, here is a builder that hasn't demonstrated to me that I want to work with them. And that might not happen on the first touch point. You know, the first touch point might be a little bit of a grey area and you give them the benefit of the doubt. Then you agree to meet them somewhere and they turn up an hour late. And it's like, right, now we've got a second negative. Now they've taken to see me to show me another project, and the quality doesn't look so good. I think this is the end of the communication. We don't need to work together.
Yeah.
But doing all of that remotely really is impossible, because I could show you, yeah, I could take you on a guided tour around my house here, but I would only show you the things that would highlight the quality of this house.
Yeah.
It wouldn't necessarily show you defects. It wouldn't show you, because that's what builders will do. If you ask them to send you a video, they will only video what looks good. I've had builders submit photos to clients. I've had clients contact me looking for help with builders when they've fallen out. And I said, where's the photos of what they've done? And they send me the photos and I'm saying, I think they photographed the same room three times. I don't think this is three separate rooms. You know, it feels like it's all, you know, but they've persuaded the client that, look, three rooms are being decorated. Actually, one room's being decorated. The other rooms are still back at bare brickwork.
That actually happened in Sweden. Swedish investors, they got sent the same picture because they bought like a block of flats and they were sent the same, exactly, just one picture to all of the investors.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's it. So you can't be having someone on the ground that is your eyes and ears.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, fair enough. Fair enough. So should you tell your builder or your builder your budget?
I think it's worth being vague over the budget. So if I'm looking for a builder to price a project, I will often say it's around about £100,000 or it's around about £50,000. And I think the reason for that is, first of all, it demonstrates a bit of credibility. It demonstrates that you kind of know what you're expecting. But secondly, it also gives some builders the opportunity to say, look, actually, at £50,000, I'm not going to be the right contractor. Yeah, I'm too big. Or at £150,000, I'm not going to be the right contractor. There's only me and a mate, and we're not going to be able to cope with it. So I think, yeah, I wouldn't, if I was expecting a job to come out at £150,000, I would probably say to a builder, I've got this project, it's somewhere between 125 and 100, yeah, 160 or something like that. Keep it on the low side, but don't go too low, because if you say, yeah, if you say I've got this job and it's going to be about £50,000 and they walk round and think there's no way this is £50,000, they're immediately thinking that this guy's a bit of a waster. He's wasting my time. And at the moment, whilst builders are busy, they just won't price. I was talking to a lady yesterday and she was saying, I'm really struggling to get builders to price my project for me. And when she showed me what she was giving them, it was rubbish. So, of course, because they're busy, they're just, I said to her, you've got no credibility. They can't, she had planning drawings and that was it. No schedule of works, didn't know anything, didn't even have a realistic budget. So, of course, every question they'd asked her, she wasn't coming across as credible. So as a result, none of them were pricing. So yeah, share your budget, but keep it on a bit on the low side, but be reasonable about it.
So should you have a fixed term or should you have an hourly rate when you're using builders?
So always a fixed price. Always a fixed price. The only time you have an hourly rate is when you phone a man up or to do some emergency work. You're an emergency plumber. We don't know how long he's going to be there to stop the water. That is hourly rates. Anything else that has been designed and been thought about, you should be getting a fixed price. Because let's say you've got a £50,000 budget and the builders give you a price of £60,000. Well, before the job has even started, you know you've got to find £10,000 more. And you've got two options with that. You either go and borrow another £10,000 or you find a way of saving £10,000 out of the project somehow. But you know where you are before you started. The worst thing that can happen, and this is what builders really hate and why they're doing their due diligence on you at the same time as you're doing it on them, is they won't want, do it on a time and materials basis. It gets to the end, they haven't finished, and you've spent all of your money, and now you've got a project that isn't finished. You haven't got the £10,000 because you weren't aware of it. And by the way, it's going to cost you £70,000 because the builder now isn't motivated to finish everything in the fixed price he gave you. So if it takes a little bit longer, well, we'll take a little bit longer at it. And if we've gone home early to watch the football or whatever, the client won't know. So I can still charge a whole day. So you've got no control if you're doing anything on an hourly rate, which, as I say, for an emergency repair and some handyman work between tenants, that kind of happens. But projects like this should be designed. And if builders are saying to you, there's not enough information. I need to price this on a, yeah, I just need to give you an hourly rate. Then either they're not a competent builder, or you actually haven't designed it well enough in the first place that they can actually understand what you want.
Okay, good, good answer. So what terms should you have with your builder?
So the key thing about agreeing terms, well, you've got two options with terms. You can have a formal contract, but if you don't want that, you can agree terms. The basic terms, and some of these are real basic, is what is your trading name and address? You know, it's not necessarily your name. It may well be your company, you know, and what's the trading address? Because that, you know, you've got an agreement here. You're going to create a legal agreement between two companies. It may not be you and the builder. It's your business and his business. So what's your name and address? What's his name and address? And again, it's not Fred the Builder. It's Fred the Builder and Sons Limited or whatever it is. And then what is the contract sum? How much have you agreed to pay the builder for doing these works? Is that number written down and clear? Does it include or exclude VAT? What documents has the builder based that price on? So it might have been some drawings. It might have been a schedule of works. It might be that you've sent a couple of emails since then where you've clarified some bits and he's added a little bit more in. All of those documents are relevant, drawings and things like that. So just trying to work through that. Now then we've got, what are the terms for payment? So how often are we going to agree how much is paid and how quickly after that day are we going to pay the builder? Because if we agree this with the builder up front, there's no surprises. What is the process for sorting out variations and changes? Do you want the builder to price everything before anything goes ahead? Are you happy to take a bit more of a risk? Is it you that gives the instructions or is it your business partner? I've had projects where business partners have come down and started instructing builders and the budget runs away with it because one guy's got the budget and the other guy's instructing loads of work. So being clear with builders about that. What's the, I missed this one out. What's the completion date? How long is the project scheduled to take? And irrespective of what the builder tells you, always add 2 weeks into your head because it will invariably run late. But try and focus on that. Are you going to agree some damages for late completion or even a bonus if the builder finishes early? Yeah, if you can agree all of that, that's good. And then kind of anything else that you think just needs clarifying before you start the project. What I always encourage people to do is don't do this over the phone if you can avoid it. You know, Zoom's not so bad, but try and do it face to face. Don't do it in the property. The property invariably hasn't got any furniture. Go to the cafe around the corner, get a cup of tea, sit down at a table, two of you, and have a business meeting. Discuss this project through properly because you are committing to a relationship here. Discuss it all properly. One of you confirm it, maybe back in an email. You can, if you want to, put it onto a formal document, both parties sign, but it brings them together. Discussing anything, you know, if you've got a critical element, you must finish this bit first. You must finish this bedroom first because I want to put furniture in it and take some photos. Have that discussion up front so the builder knows how to do it. It's like doing show flats and things like that. I need this to happen or I need your help with this bit. Anything like that wants to be discussed up front because then the builder can factor it in to the way they run a job, and all of that can become part of your terms.
Okay, yeah, that's great. So how should you pay your builders? How do you pay your builders? So what do you recommend?
So per se, I start with most contractors on the smaller projects by saying that we will value their work every 2 weeks. So they do 2 weeks of work. We go to site on that day and we say, how much work have they done? And then depending on payment, normally pay within 7 days. typically on my projects where I've got the money in my bank, I'll normally pay within about 48 hours. And I only say 48 hours to make sure that, you know, I haven't got a glitch the following day and I miss payment. But yeah, some clients say 14 days, which is more appropriate if you're getting funds from elsewhere. You know, if you've got an investor paying you funds, sometimes there needs to be a bit of time in it. So, but yeah, typically every 2 weeks we're paying builders. Where I can, I avoid paying a deposit. If I am paying a deposit, it will not be, I'd be surprised. I don't think you'd get a deposit of more than about £3,000, maybe £5,000 from me, per se, a few thousand pounds tops. I would rather not pay a deposit and do the first payment at the end of the first week if I needed to, than pay a deposit, because I really want to know that a builder has committed to deliver this project. But in many ways, this all goes back to the previous bit about terms. If we've had a business relationship, business meeting discussing terms, both parties have already got enough trust. So the builder shouldn't be in a position saying, well, I need some money in case you do a runner. It's like, well, hold on, if you're thinking I'm doing a runner, we haven't got this business trust that we're going to need to work together. Therefore, something else isn't right. And by the way, I can't do a runner. You know where the house is that I own. You know, the higher risk is the builder doing a runner and leaving the property investor high and dry. But the builders see it the other way around. They think they're at risk. But this is because they've dealt with people in the past and still will deal with people that are less honourable.
And
unfortunately, there are property investors out there, you know, ripping builders off and getting us all a bad name. So some builders are, sceptical of property investors, unfortunately.
Yeah. So this question is actually from my missus. So she asked, costs in Sweden are much higher than in the UK. What should people expect to pay for a total refurb of a kitchen and bath? And I know obviously in the north it's much cheaper and in the south, but maybe you could take like both scenarios, who knows?
Yeah, okay. So let's start with a kitchen. So if we're just gonna strip out a kitchen and put a new kitchen in, then smaller kitchens will start at, you know, probably £3,000, and then start rising from there. Where people catch a cold in a kitchen is as soon as you want to start moving the services around. So we've got the sink on this wall, now we want it on this wall, now we've got a whole bunch of pipework to worry about. And this is where the cost, so the basic cost, you know, if you've got a rundown kitchen, whip it out, put a new one in, start at £3,000. Start moving pipework, now you're at £3,500. Now we need the gas cooker moved, now we're going to block up the door, now we've got to do this and that and everything else. And suddenly we're up at £4,000, £5,000. And that's how it starts to go. Now, if we start looking at things like HMO kitchens, which are traditionally that much bigger, sometimes with two sinks in, not thinking built-in appliances necessarily, but space for more appliances, you know, you can very easily find, including the cost of appliances, you're up around £8,000 or so just of the kitchen itself, leave alone any structural alterations you make to create this, yeah, this bigger kitchen dining area. So, family houses, small kitchens, 3,000, big kitchens, 4, 5. HMOs probably start at 4 or 5 and go up towards 8. If you're doing luxury high end, yeah, then it can very easily escalate even more than that. But as I say, it's not the kitchen units per se that's the cost. It's all of those ancillary things. And it's all those things that when you go to the kitchen supply company, they sell you all the nice to haves. Well, you could just have this nice corner carousel unit that comes out when you open the door. And it's like, but by the way, that's adding £250 into that unit that you don't necessarily need it on a bog standard rental property. So, you know, it's looking through things like that. And in many ways, the same with the bathrooms. You know, if you just whip out what's there and put new in, the average wash basin, toilet, shower cubicle, shower tray, you'll get change out of £1,000 for that. You can get a reasonable quality for £800-900 in all of that. Add on, if you want an electric shower, that's another £150-200. That's assuming you're plumbing in through the mains. So the bits you need to £1,000, and to swap it all over, in a lot of cases, another £1,000, until you want all of the tiles hacked off, and now we've got to repair all the wall, and we've got to put new tiles up, and now we're going to put flooring down on top of that, and we're going to rehang the door, and we got a nice new handle, and we're going to redo the lighting, and it's when these extra bits get added on. Yeah, so smaller bathrooms, somewhere around about £2,000, they'll creep up, but not that high, really. You know, even bigger bathrooms don't cost you much more. If you've got a bath and a shower, that adds in only another £400-500 or so. But so watch things like tiling. And some of the clients I talk to, they want to fully tile their whole bathroom, which is great. But there's a lot of cost in all of that, not so much the tiles, but the labour, paying someone to tile all of that bathroom. There's a lot of work in there, and tilers are quite expensive trade. And it's like, does this property demand a fully tiled bathroom? If you're in Knightsbridge, fully tile it in limestone. But if you're at the back end of nowhere doing student accommodation, it doesn't need loads of tiling. It needs the shower tiled, and probably a splashback behind the basin, and that's probably it. So be reasonable about what's needed to keep the cost down, but bear in mind it's not the basic cost of changing things over. It's all of those nice to haves that we invariably add on afterwards.
Yeah. So that was a really good answer, and I have a follow up question regarding what have you seen. Refurbishment before, like in the 80s, 90s, and the 00s, and now moving forward, that the standard, and what do you really need? Like example, like you're seeing in HMOs now that some have USB ports in their sockets and etc. Where do you see we're going, and how? Yeah,
good question. So from an HMO perspective, it is a lot more, I'm seeing now, a lot more kind of what we call co-living, but also coexisting to the extent that we are living in our bedrooms, we're working in a living room, we're sharing dining space with other people. So I'm seeing HMOs, we're adding in better workstations, better places where tenants can use their laptop and possibly even have a Zoom call kind of arrangement without it looking like they're sitting on their bed. Definitely USB. I'm seeing a lean towards green energy. I'm seeing a lean towards solar panels and things like more awareness of EPC. So more awareness of insulation, the better control of the heating. We're controlling heating now through apps on our phones and things like that. As technology, as much as that technology is helping us keep the cost down for us as an investor, it's generally helping the tenants be more environmentally friendly. And the other big thing is we're doing a lot more now with these shower boards. So the pre-finished boards instead of tiling, because they are quicker and easier to install. They're more expensive than tiling to buy, but quicker and easier to install. They're lower maintenance. We don't get silicon. We don't get grout cracking and things like that. So, they're kind of new products that are coming in. And I'm also seeing, not that I've really done much with any of my clients, but there's this whole move to make, certainly city centre HMOs stand out from the others with smart feature walls, not just a painted colour, but now, imitation brickwork, timber cladding, feature details, in some respects, styling that's a little bit more, yeah, more aligned to things like, yeah, Starbucks, and a wine bar than what we might see as residential. But this is because tenants are living and working from home, and yeah, they want to work in an environment that doesn't feel like a bedroom or feel like a house. It feels like more of a work environment. So that's, yeah, okay. That's where I'm seeing things going. And I think there'll be more creativity come around this work from home environment over the next few years.
Okay. That's some good tips. So coming to snagging, do you have any tips about snagging?
Yeah. Big tip about snagging is don't leave it until the end of the job. So that's my big tip. So if I'm walking around a project with a builder and there is clearly something not right, I will flag it up there and then. The worst thing you can do to a builder is say, yeah, this has been rubbish for the last 10 weeks and now I'm not happy with it. You know, if you weren't happy with it 10 weeks ago, say you're not happy. Now, how you say that to the builder will differ. It depends on your relationship with the builder. Sometimes I might be up front with a builder and say, look, the quality of this plastering is not right. You need to get this better. I might even say, yeah, I hope you haven't paid the plasterer for this because it's rubbish. And sometimes the builder will say, it was me. And you'll get that. But you know, flag it up there and then. And I say, you know, and if the builder's done one thing, let's say he's hung a door and he's fitted some handles on it, and I'm not happy with it, I'll talk to him about that one door and say, you know, this needs to improve for the other eight doors you're going to do. I'm not going to accept this if you haven't sorted this out. But don't let them finish the whole thing and then create, then come up with a list. But my other tip with snagging is I as a client should not be snagging their work for obvious defects. I should be really casting my eye over it. So I should go into a room and have no more than two or three items of snagging in there. So if there's more than that, then that means the job's not finished. It becomes a to-do list rather than a snagging list. You know, if you open the first door and let's say there's no handle on the first door, then that's not ready for snagging. You know, there is a fundamental thing that's missing. If the handle is slightly wonky or it's a little bit stiff, that's snagging. That's what you should be looking at. You know, if there's a socket not quite level, there's a little bit of a blemish on the paintwork, but it's a little bit of blemish on the paintwork, not something that as soon as you walk in, even the blind man would have seen it. That's incomplete. I had a builder offer me a project for snagging a couple of weeks ago, and we went into two rooms and it was like, this is nowhere near ready. Yeah, we've already filled one side of A4 paper here with basics. We're going to come back next week. In fact, we're going back tomorrow to do that and finish it all off because it wasn't ready at the time. But what we did pointed out to him some things that we would want him to sort out, which was that he had the same issues all over the place. You know, he'd got some materials missing, so he hadn't finished off all of the showers. And it was like, that it's not ready. Yeah, you know, I really want, when I was a building contractor, when I was managing building projects, when I did snagging with my client, I used to have a handyman with me and a screwdriver in my pocket. And I'd have a client say, the screw on that light switch isn't quite vertical. And I'd take the screwdriver out and we'd do that. And I'd say, right, don't write that on the list. And I'd have a handyman there and the architect would say, there's a little bit of paint miss over here. And he'd quickly whip out a brush and he'd quickly do it. It's that kind of job. Something that can be done as you walk around. Anything more than that is not snagging. But you should get to that point if you flagged up the issues nice and early on, when they first become obvious.
Okay. So you mentioned before apps. What software app should you use with your builder?
With smaller projects, I would say don't impose an app on the builder. Ask the builder what he's happy to use. So some builders will say, oh, I create a WhatsApp group for all of my projects. We'll do it all on WhatsApp. Some will say, I'll send you text. Some will say, oh, my wife will send emails at night, whatever it is. I think builders are not in this world to be using clever apps. They're doing a practical thing. Yeah, they're out on site. They've got dirty overalls on. They've got heavy boots. They've got gloves on. They're not the kind of people that are per se using apps. If you're doing bigger projects, if you're building a block of flats, you're dealing with a much bigger contractor, they will want to use apps. But do you know, there's a number of project management type apps coming on the market. I'm trialing a couple at the moment. I have to say none of them are perfect for what I want at the moment, but I'm working with one to try and help them build it a bit better. But what you can't be Word and Excel. You know, actually, if you want a list of something, put it in Word. If you want something that's a bit easier, put it in Excel. Don't feel that you have to use an app. Yeah, because some of these apps, I think some people use apps for app's sake. And actually, you know, we've had Word and Excel for years, and it works in a lot of cases. And, you know, a lot of these builders don't want anything special. If you turned up on site with a builder and gave him a list of 8 things on a piece of paper, there's, you know, he'll pin it on a board somewhere, he'll stick it on the wall, and the likelihood is it will get done. If you try and use a fancy app, the likelihood is he's probably broken the phone trying to open it, he dropped it off the scaffold, fallen down a toilet, you know, and by the way, he now can't do anything until he gets home, when his wife can, you know, log him back in because he's forgotten his password. And I know that it might sound as though I'm taking a mickey out of builders, but this is part of the understanding of builders. Builders are practical people. They're out there, they're doing it day in. They're in the muck and everything. They don't want to be held up by a little bit of formality of some apps. So, yeah, hence, you will find a builder's got the most expensive iPhone, by the way, but he probably doesn't use anything more than WhatsApp and text messages on it. And he'll phone the merchants, but he will, yeah, because that's how a lot of builders are. Yeah, they want the material possessions, but they're not using them to the capacity, you know, the capacity that they're capable of operating.
Okay. So what bad recommendation do you hear in the industry regarding refurbishment?
I think the bad recommendation really is that you don't need a project manager and you don't need help with your refurbishment. There's a lot of people out there that have kind of got this view, I think. Well, I had the kitchen refitted last year, so I dealt with a tradesman there, and I painted the back bedroom earlier this year. So I kind of know all about managing refurbishments. And I think, absolutely, on smaller, easy projects, you'll get away with it. But as you start to grow, you'll find you've got some fundamental gaps in your knowledge that could have been plugged up from the beginning. And I meet a lot of property investors, and they're saying how much profit they made from a flip or how much value they've added. And then they talk me through what they're doing. And I'm thinking, wow, you know, if you had known this, you could have doubled that profit. But there's unfortunately training within, I mean, you'll be aware of this, training within property investing has got or can get a bad press. Yeah. And I think there's unfortunately a lot of people that say you don't need training. You can find it all out on Facebook. You can ask in forums. But actually, as I say, you don't know what you don't know. I had a client, a good client now, actually. He contacted me. He was the first client I had after I wound up my building business and became a consultant. I'd priced a project for him as a builder. And I'd lost it. And he rang me up a few months later. He said, Martin, I need some help. And I said, really sorry, I'm not a building contractor anymore. He said, oh, what are you doing? I told him I'm a consultant. He said, no, that's exactly what I need. So I said, well, what do you want? He said, I've been running my business for 10 years. I started off buying a 1-bedroom flat, moving the kitchen and selling it as a 2-bedroom flat. I've grown and grown and grown. I'm now building flats. I'm now converting houses into multiple flats. He said, I've never once reviewed my processes in my construction end of things. Can you come into my business for a bit and review what I'm doing? So in I go to his business, starting on Monday morning. He rings me at 12 o'clock. He said, Martin, we'll go out for lunch. So we're sitting having lunch. And he said to me, so how much work do you think there is here for you? And I hadn't said anything, but clearly my face had given it away. And he said, oh, well, I've got a lot of a mess going on then. I said, well, you haven't got a lot of mess, but there's a lot of places I could just tighten a screw here. I could tidy a process for you. But I said, we can't change everything overnight. We've just got to slowly, slowly work on things. And I worked for him. I worked for him kind of three, four days a week for 2 years in the end. I did do some project management, but we tightened up a lot of things. And a lot of things he didn't know were broken. You know, it was only when I reported back and said, do you know, this is how we would do it. You know, I put him in touch with a local wholesaler for ironmongery, door handles and things like that, who could get end of range stock at rock bottom prices. So now whenever he has a project, instead of going and buy something that's over the counter at full price, he phones up the wholesaler and says, what deals have you got? I need 8 handles that are going to be suitable for this kind of property. What deals have you got in? And suddenly he's paying, and he might only be paying £1 less for every handle, but multiply that across everything he's doing and every part of the trade and all of the processes, you know, some of that we improve, some of the contractual processes and things like that. And I think this is where I see an awful lot of property investors. This guy, I always talk about him because he was honest. He didn't know what he didn't know. He had built his business up and he was open to say, Martin, come into my business and critique it and help me improve it. And he is absolutely flying now. You know, he is doing incredibly well. He's out and about. You see him all over the circuit. But I was there early on. But the key thing was I helped sort out the construction side, but he also brought in people into other parts of his business to sort out that. So he spent a lot of time and effort really sorting the business out. So he just skyrocketed in a 2-year period, really. And,
wow.
And I think other property investors could do that if they just opened up and said, you know, I don't think I know how to do this the best way. I think I'm just winging it and getting away with it. And what will happen is we'll see a downturn in the market. We'll see a point where prices are harder to meet. And they'll be the people that are in all sorts of trouble.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a good answer for all of those doubters.
Yeah.
So I've come to the end. This has been so information packed. So I have 2 more questions.
Okay.
So if you could give one piece of advice to someone starting property, what would that be?
It's got to go back to that previous question. Get some education. I got educated partly because I wanted to know how my skills fitted alongside property investing. But someone said to me a couple of years ago now, how much have I spent on education? And I was saying, well, yeah, I mean, it runs into tens of thousands. But I also said, at the same time, you should be asking me, but how much money have I saved as a result? And, and just last year on its own, I bought a property that was certified £100,000 below market value, which I would not have bought if I didn't have the skills from training, leave alone the other deals I bought that have all had good equity in them. And I think, it comes back. I think I had been working 20 something years. I'd been employed, never thought I needed more education after I got a degree. But now I've realized the power of education. I've nigh on constantly been in some kind of education system since 2013. And I'm doing education now, business and property all connected together. And I think that would be my advice to anyone. And if you haven't got the money to get education, then you haven't got the money to buy property. You know, spend that first bit of money on getting education, because you'll get far better return out of it than you will buying the wrong property and maybe getting hacked off along the way.
Yeah, that's a good answer. So now I want to know 3 best books, business or property related.
So I knew you were going to ask me this. So I had a bit of time to think about it, because 3 is tough. But I've got something. I'm going to mention the first property book I ever read. And I still say to anyone, if you want a real introduction to property that just sows some seeds, you're not going to learn everything, but it will sow seeds and get you going. That first book I read was Property Magic by Simon Zucci. And I've done a lot of work with Simon Zucci since. In fact, Simon is one of my clients. So he phones me up when he's got problems in his projects. but I think it's an easy read. I can remember exactly where I was when I read it. I was on holiday at the time. I remember sitting, reading this book. I couldn't put it down, and it got me going. Soon after that, then one of the next books I read was Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill, which is a book I've dipped into a lot since. And I think, you know, it's got something like 12 chapters in it. Different chapters resonate at different times of your life and different times in your career. The thing for me about Think and Grow Rich was it was the first book I listened to rather than read. And so that in itself was a real eye-opener as to the benefits. I can remember where I was again. I was in the car and we were driving. We were listening to this. And I suddenly realized the benefits of the time saving, that instead of listening to the radio, there was actually some knowledge I could be getting. And it's a book that I dip in and out of every now and again, because I think each chapter stands on its own, and you can read the chapter when you are wanting to, when the right chapter resonates for your journey, wherever you are in it. I know everyone always says Rich Dad, Poor Dad. Rich Dad, Poor Dad, I think I read that at the wrong time. That didn't resonate quite so much with me, although I understand it. I think the other book I was going to say that I think really just gave me confidence is actually the book that I've got is Losing My Virginity by Richard Branson, his autobiography. But I'd say any book by Richard Branson, because it is just full of business. I read Losing My Virginity. In fact, I read that before I was even running my own business. But there was just some seeds being sown from it of what I could get. And when I was employed at the time, thinking, is it right for me to set up my own business? Should I just go and get a job with someone else? I think reading that book just gave me an insight that, there's some benefits from business. Yes, it's hard work, but it's not impossible. And in fact, I've read a lot more of Richard's books since. In fact, I've probably read all of them since. And it's highs and lows. He has the problems, but he gets over them, and it's how he solves them. And I'm intrigued to read what I'm sure will be another book coming out soon about how he's got over coronavirus and all of the issues with his airlines. And I think it was enough to get me confidence. In fact, the kind of book I really like are business autobiographies, because I think you can learn from them, but it's also like this isn't made up. This is genuine stuff that's happened, and this is how people have genuinely solved some of the challenges they've got on. So they're the three
great books, books. I've read them all, but they're great. Like you mentioned, they're great. And if listeners haven't read them, they should definitely read them. So if people want to get in touch with you, because I know you have a YouTube channel that's very good, you maybe want to plug that in. And how they can get a hold of you.
Yeah, get in touch with me. So Refurbishment Mastery is my business. So look at Refurbishment Mastery. We're on YouTube, as Nana says. We're also on Facebook. So have a look there. Have a look on the website as well for Refurbishment Mastery. There's some other resources on there. I'd be delighted if anything I've spoken about just resonates, then I would be delighted if you pick up a copy of my book on the website. It's we give it away free, just pay postage and packaging. It's just an overview. I wrote it for property investors to help them understand how refurbishment works. And on that same website, if you want to have a free call with me, there's a button at the top that says book a call. It'll take you to my diary, and you can find a 20-minute slot, and we'll have a free chat about anything to do with refurbishment or property investing and development and anything like that. I'm kind of here to help people. I'd much rather help people before they get themselves into a mix up. I don't mind helping them after they've gotten a mix up, but I'd rather help them before they get in a mix up and see if we can keep them going in the right way forward. But yeah, start on social media. It's all free stuff.
Okay. And I will get that book on your website, obviously.
Excellent.
And I just want to say thank you very much for taking your time to helping the listeners how to do a proper refurb and what ask question they should ask and etc. Thank you very much.
That's all right. It's been really good speaking to you. You've had some good questions there, some things that made me think. So some good stuff to cover off. So yeah, really enjoyed it. Thanks very much.
Thank you. And people, don't be stressed. Invest, people.